Thank you. And as he's already mentioned, much of this has been building upon itself. It's building upon itself because what we are trying to do with the dynamic of not having our gospel priorities be aspirational, but actual functional, and something that we utilize in ways that help us to be more effective in the way we do ministry. And so when we talk about this presentation here, one of the things I want you to acknowledge is the fact that the hard work that we're trying to communicate and try to be translated to you all is that we want to resource you. We want to come alongside of you. And we sincerely mean that, and we hope that you hear and understand that everything that we're doing, if you then have any questions or needs, what we want to do, Gabriel, Tom, Bob, myself, Dean, Annie Rose, the rest of our teams, we want to come alongside of each of you. And so that is what you'll hear me communicate in some way this afternoon. You guys have been very good at paying attention, and after lunch, you're coming in, so I won't put you to sleep, okay? I may tell a couple jokes, may keep you alive, but I'm grateful that you're here. I got one question, though. A question that can be asked several different ways. Do you think that God sends an angry, hateful, and unhealthy leader? You can say pastor, elder, deacon, youth ministry, nursery worker. Do you think you'd send them to proclaim a loving gospel? Do you think that God would send an angry, hateful, unhealthy child of God to proclaim a loving gospel? The reason I ask that is because when we look at John 3:16, Jesus came into the world because God so, I can't hear you, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever will believe will have what? And then you go to John 17:20-26, where Jesus is praying for us. And in that prayer, he prays a lot of what Aaron emphasized this morning, that we become perfectly one. That we become perfectly, I can't hear you, beloved. I'm gonna make you talk this afternoon. That we become perfectly one. The faster y'all communicate back to me, the faster I will be done. I guarantee. Amen, somebody. And so when you think about the idea in which God is emphasizing this lovingness and sending, God then sends loving people, send loving people to proclaim a loving gospel. I want you to understand that, because when John is emphasizing this idea of love and this idea of us becoming perfectly one, it's because the apostles are preaching and teaching the word. But Jesus, nor does the disciples go out and make sure that everything is functioning perfectly in its orthodoxy and its orthopraxy and all of the things that we created and developed with great wisdom in order for the church to function. But he makes it clear that the articulation of the gospel has to match the acts of the gospel in which we proclaim. Therefore, when we talk about the Great Commission, we can't do it without talking about the Great Commandment. Our love for one another is actually a visible proclamation to the world that we are disciples of Jesus Christ. And so, beloved, when you think about who we are as effective biblical leaders, we're disciples. That's our way of saying discipleship as a denomination. Everybody say effective, effective. Biblical. Leaders. Everybody say effective. Biblical. Leaders. That's you. That's you. That is you. Every person that is in this room, that is you. That is your ruling elders. That's your session. That's every teaching elder. That's every missionary. that we've prayed for here last night and from previous years and the ones that will come for years to come. That's every youth worker, every nursery worker, every child worker that is in your congregation, every deacon, every individual that is in your congregation, in your church, that makes Sunday morning be what it is, and throughout the week serving your community, it is you that is supposed to be an effective biblical leader. But what kind? Not a hateful one, not an angry one, not an unhealthy one, but a loving one. And so when you see in our slide that we emphasize the vision of the EPC, what we're trying to emphasize is that to the glory of God, the EPC, the EPC, everybody say family. That's what we are. You're my family. Aspires to embody and proclaim Jesus' love as a, everybody say, global movement of congregations engaged together in God's mission through, everybody say, transformation, multiplication, and effective biblical leadership. The emphasis here is for you to understand that these are not just what we desire to do, but these are things that we want to implement and come alongside in order to resource all of our leaders. And we define an effective biblical leader as people who are increasingly Christ-like character whose example and passion inspires others to follow Christ. That's what we define it as. Many others can say various different things, but we define it that way primarily because we understand that everybody that we follow doesn't have to be a platform preacher. Amen, somebody. But yet we have at times desire to follow platforms over faithful, godly people to shepherd our hearts. And so then when you look at the team, the next team, they're here. These are faithful, godly people that are on the effective biblical leadership team to help these things come to fruition. They will introduce themselves. Some of you know them because they're in your presbytery. And this team has been established for quite some time. Jerry Iamiri helped put some of this team together. And they have been thinking about discipleship and what it means to come alongside of others in our denomination. They will come up and introduce themselves later in this presentation. And so now, when you think about, okay, where God is sending loving people, not hateful people, what are we saying then? The situation that I want you to understand, big idea, pastors, leaders, teaching elders, ruling elders, youth workers. I know it says on this next slide, it says pastors, but I want to emphasize the fact that it's not just emphasizing those that are ordained. Everybody in your church that is shepherding and caring for those are effective biblical leaders, but they're less effective when they're not adequately resourced. When you're not adequately resourced, it's hard to be effective. Amen? And so then, what does it mean to be adequately resourced? Many of you could be thinking a myriad of things. That means financially, that means having better strategies and having better programs and having a building. I don't think that that's what we're trying to emphasize for this particular time for our effective biblical leaders. In fact, what we're saying is those that are exhausted and have poor mental health, emotional health, spiritual health, and physical health, what happens is when they're not resourced in these areas, you can give them $1 million. But it doesn't mean that they will be an effective biblical leader. Are y'all tracking with me? Therefore, when you think about that, we have to say then, when we come alongside our leaders and we hear issues of burnout, et cetera, here's what we want to do. We want to equip, we want to empower, we want to establish and encourage leaders. That's how we want to meet the situation. That's how we want to address the complication. And we want to answer those questions primarily because when we equip everyone, this whole idea of equipping you throughout this time is to give you things in order for you to do your work well. for us all to do it well. We want to empower those that are our youth workers, those that are our next generation workers, those that are in our seminaries and we're sending off, and even our more seasoned and retired pastors. We want to empower all to continue to do and carry out the mission which God has called us to for the glory of God, and establish upon a firm foundation, upon a solid rock in which we establish our leaders, not in things in which we are saying that it's leading them to unhealth. We want to establish them to be healthy, build better rhythms, and allow them to flourish and be effective in those ways, not necessarily saying we want to put them on the best platforms. We want to give them all of what they need, because I'm going to tell you right now, you can give someone that you believe will be a great leader, you can give them everything, but it doesn't mean that it will pan out if they have not addressed what's under the iceberg. See, when you think about encouraging leaders, a lot of times, remember when you, if you ever preach, all of us, you know, at some point teach or preach, and sometimes when you look for that affirmation, or you've never done it before, or something, or you're doing some kind of work around the church, it means a lot when you step off the stage and you feel completely horrible, that you feel like you have not communicated effectively, you have not done ministry effectively, you feel as if you kind of inwardly start digging at yourself. But then that one person comes up and says, that was tremendously helpful for me. That blessed me. I was in a season where those words really helped me. It's to understand that that whenever you step out and do ministry, you're not stepping out doing ministry into an abyss of hateful people. You want to be encouraged in your work. So when you look at this next slide, a lot of times it's hard to be encouraged when you are one at the top, and this was born as research, there's a low retention of pastoral leadership, and unhealthy pastors will lead to unhealthy churches. And so when you look at this, you see the navy blue is very satisfied, somewhat satisfied there in the middle, not too satisfied, and not at all satisfied, and not sure. And this is dealing with the question of how satisfied would you say you feel with your vocation as a pastor, maybe even as you serve in your church, how satisfied? And you can see there's a great amount of individuals that do not feel satisfied. And you can even see the age dynamic in which you see there's a growing and increasing amount of individuals quitting ministry at a younger age. Now, does that mean that they don't have everything that they need? Does it mean that they're less effective because they went to seminary and seminary didn't give them all of the tools that they needed? Does it mean that they haven't been able to adequately exegete or adequately galvanize and corral people? It doesn't necessarily mean that. It means a lot of times that they have issues that are unaddressed and probably bad rhythms that they've adopted that led them to be ineffective or into poor health. A testimony for me, and many of you all may feel this same thing, when I was pastoring in the pandemic in 2020, there had to be a change for me in that year, that month, September. And that change, I told a couple of my close colleagues, I was like, I knew that I was going down the wrong path when I started eating Frosted Flakes at 11 p.m. at night. If you see me eating Frosted Flakes, you slap them on my hands, okay? At the Hampton Inn, they got Frosted Flakes right there. Now I'm trying to stay away from them. But what happened was, I kid you not, I was eating, and I was just like, Mike, what are you doing? But that small thing let me know that I was stressed. Probably over anxious, out of shape, in various different ways. And that's what I was doing to just cope and deal with the moment and all of the stress of trying to adapt and change in situations. Many of you have felt that. And I can tell you now that it doesn't feel good. And so the change that I had to make for me is I had to work out. I had to meet with my therapist more. I had to be able to talk and engage with a level of emotional intelligence to know where I am and how I'm feeling and what are the things that are actually making me feel particular ways, and how can I preach effectively when I'm feeling unhealthy, when I'm angry, and I just start preaching angry sermons? I can start preaching unhealthy sermons because of my health. And so when you understand that as an effective biblical leader, our goal is this team and at the OGA is that we want to resource leaders to become resilient and reproduce more effective biblical leaders. When you're resilient, that means that you're actually more self-aware. Everybody say self-aware, self-aware. Leader, team-aware, and leader-aware. When you have a deeper self-awareness, what happens is you do not begin to actually impose what is going on under the iceberg with yourself and to everybody else around you. Toxic leadership teams, toxic volunteers. You begin to distribute toxicity because you haven't addressed the health in your heart, in your mind. See, pastors are trending in the opposite direction of burnout. This is deeply due to the fact that they're connected to community, mentors, I would say coaches, and they are pastored by a sage pastor, someone that has been there where they are, and they routinely Sabbath. So now we're getting to some of the answers. Not all of the answers. We'll get some of the answers. And the answers that we are trying to articulate is that we want to make sure that our pastors who are actually discipling others will be being the ones that are discipled. Our pastors that are discipling will be ones that are being discipled. We can't ask people to go out and disciple other people and then they're not the ones that are being discipled. They're not the ones that are being built up. Nobody recognizes their unhealthy habits. And so what we see is here on this next slide, the effort that we're trying to make is we want to do it collaboratively. We want effective biblical leadership, church planning, church health, and global movement at the General Assembly level to have a level of alignment through our presbyteries and our congregations. Next slide. And when we see when those things happen, what happens is just like Mike Moses gave you an example of trying to build committees and commissions to allow you to do more effective church planning. What happens is you begin to learn from one another in your presbyteries and in your areas. And so this resource slide is to show you that at the MVC level, what we're trying to do is, and you'll get much of this tomorrow in your equipping session, biblical and theological expertise, character and spiritual formation, and organizational leadership. These are three areas that our Ministerial Vocation Committee did some research on to say that these were felt needs for a lot of our effective biblical leaders. And so we will build and resource and develop in those particular areas. And then you may ask, who is Annie Rose? She is actually on our next slide. And our next slide is actually resourcing you as people who are under the ministerial care and development to see the pastor and spouse retreats, to see the executive pastor and administrative pastor gatherings, the small church gathering that's coming up. Our chaplains just had a retreat at Glen Eyrie just this past weekend, and they were able to get away and build together. We also have a Next Gen Summit that we meet in October where we bring leaders that are Next Gen leaders from around the nation to come together and build and resource them up. All of our committees that we have, we do the same exact thing and trying to pour in and build with them. And what we want you to consistently hear is, why are we spending so much time on trying to build healthy people? Why are we trying to build healthy leaders? Who really needs to Sabbath? Who really needs to care about their mental health, their spiritual or their physical health? You're human beings. We're all human beings and we have limits. And effective human beings and effective leaders will know their limits. They will know what is too much. They will know when they are feeling stressed, overly anxious, depressed. They'll understand that how much they're taking on is too much and their capacity is limited. Therefore, they won't take on more that will cause them to burn out faster. Are y'all tracking with me? And so when you hear about all of the resources and you hear what we're trying to develop and come alongside, it goes back to the situation in which we ask, does God send angry, unhealthy, and hateful people effective biblical leaders to proclaim a loving gospel? God sends a loving people who've been deeply transformed, who's come to grips with their limitations and how God empowers them and equips them and establishes them and encourages them in their efforts to do ministry, in order for them to be sharpened by the community that they're in, by the mentors that they have, the coaches they have, the leaders in their life, the more sage pastors, and understanding that the rhythm that you have to have is a Sabbath because you need to get away as much as you're pouring out to others. And then you probably need to do that for your congregation. Probably need to do that for your sessions, your deacons, your youth leaders, those children workers who are in the nursery every single Sunday. And it's rare that they are able to come into fellowship with everyone else. Your health matters. And so the slide you just seen, which was listing out a lot of the other resources, was to say those were some of the partners we have. We have several different partners that help us to actually do more of carrying out the Great Commission in various different ways, from learning to retreats to development as leaders and coaching. Some of them are out there. Some of them are on our national leadership team and effective biblical leadership. And I want to invite our leadership team up now so they can introduce themselves to you all. And so we want you to know that we care about you. We care deeply. Because if you are not doing well, the church is not doing well. If the church is not doing well, you will not be doing well. Amen, somebody? I hope you feel loved. As our team comes up, I want them to take a moment to introduce themselves as we transition into our next time.
My last name is Yankee. I'm usually at the end. Now I'm at the beginning. Many of you know us as PIR, have seen me on this stage and other places. We are an EPC grown ministry, and we are a resourcing ministry to you. Our mission is to partner with God and the church, which is you, and in particular the EPC, in the work of pastoral renewal and restoration with the hope of healthy ministry lives. That's what we're about. That's why I'm so glad to be a part of this team. I'm a ruling elder in the Midwest Presbytery. You are my tribe. We love you. We want to serve you well in helping you to be an effective biblical leader.
Kent Mathews. I'm a teaching elder in Great Plains Presbytery. I serve as ministerial committee chair there. I was a local parish pastor in that presbytery for quite a few years. I am director of the Mentored Apprenticeship Program through Gordon Conwell Theological Seminary, which is the 8 required ministry study classes for ordination. And I'm president of Heartland Theological Seminary in the Kansas City area, which is a reasonably priced, fully accredited, EPC-friendly online program for ordination and a variety of other things that I do.
Hi, my name is Bonnie Gatchell, and I am a teaching elder serving Out of Bounds in the Presbytery of the East. And I serve Out of Bounds to a nonprofit called Route One Ministry. And we work with women sexually exploited and trafficked here in the United States, in particular women who work in strip clubs, and connecting them to the resources they need to exit the sex industry. In that work, over the past 13 years, we've also started developing resources and curriculum and training for pastors and congregations around trauma care. And so we're here for you if you would like to connect with us. We've done some things with the Presbytery of the Alleghenies and Rivers and Lakes. And we'd like to help support you in discovering whatever it is that you need, whatever blind spot it might be, keeping you from being the fully healthy leader that you can be so that you can lead healthy congregations. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Greg Ely. I serve as teaching elder for Colonial Presbyterian Church in Kansas City, Missouri. I also help to lead an organization in Kansas City called Unite KC, where we are working to partner churches together for the purpose of partnership and diversity.
My name is Michelle Munger. I am a ruling elder at Englewood Pres in the Coastal Mid-Atlantic Presbytery. I am also the communications and community person for the Presbytery of the Coastal Mid-Atlantic. But my personal ministry passion is supporting us in our disability ministry efforts. How do we reach the most marginalized among us, the 26% of our U.S. population that mostly cannot find a community to worship with? And my ministry, I call it At the King's Table, from 1 Samuel 9. So, and I would love to be a resource for you.
Hello, my name is Annie Rose. I'm a teaching elder. I serve as the stated clerk of Rivers and Lakes Presbytery, and I'm also blessed to serve on the GA staff as the director of ministerial support and development. So I am just overjoyed to work with this team. It has been an amazing journey so far, learning together and working together to resource the leaders in our denomination. And in my staff role, I'm particularly focused on the well-being of pastors and their families. So if you are a pastor or you know of a pastor or a pastor's spouse who's in need of support, retreat resources, counseling, any sort of thing to be a healthy disciple of Christ, please connect with me. I would love to come alongside you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Julie Hawkins, and I am a teaching elder. I serve at Chapel Hill in Gig Harbor, Washington, and I oversee our adult discipleship ministry, so I care passionately about raising up effective biblical leaders. I also love thinking about leadership pipeline, how we get more people into our denomination and into that leadership pipeline. But I think the reason that I'm on this team is because my spiritual gift is networking and connecting people and introducing people to one another. So I am here to help connect you to anyone up here or introduce you to any of my friends. And have you met my friend, Michael?
Well, will you guys please just share your love by giving a hands of applause for this team? Let me say a word of prayer, and then we'll get into our panel discussion. Father, we thank you that you care so deeply for us, that you have called us and you've loved us. And Lord, I pray that you continue to utilize this team to come alongside of all of our leaders that are in this room and those that are not in this room. And Lord, we want to build up your kingdom. We don't want to build our own. And so I pray that we continue to equip leaders for your glory and yours alone to build your kingdom. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. All God's people say together, amen. Amen. So now what we're going to have is a panel discussion. Remember, we want to hear from you as well. We don't want to assume a lot, and we want to hear some of your needs, and we want to dialogue as to what that looks like. And so a few of us will be up here to kind of share our understandings, but also engage with you in conversation. So what we'd like to happen is, if you do have a question or anything, you can either come forward and just ask your question, but we're going to start off with a couple questions to kind of get your wheels turning. That makes sense? Amen, amen. Annie Rose will be our moderator at this time.
Excellent. Well, you've already met the Effective Biblical Leadership Team. I hope you've noticed that we've added another person to our panel. We're so thankful that Gabriel de Guia has agreed to join us for this panel discussion. We wanted to have the world outreach perspective on discipleship as well as we talk together today. So Gabe, thanks for coming up and joining us.
It's great to be here.
So I'm going to start off with a couple of questions for our panelists, and then you are very welcome to go forward to the microphone to ask any questions that you might have regarding discipleship. So Julie, I'm going to start with you. The first question is, share some thoughts with us about how pastors can equip their church members to become disciplers.
Yeah, so we're going to look at this from a couple different angles here on the panel, and I want to look at it from that whole church, like 30,000 foot perspective. And I think that as teaching elders and as leaders in the church, we have this really unique thing to speak into the lives of our church and teach them how to be disciples who make disciples who make disciples and make a reproducible process. And I think that the primary ways that we can do that is beginning, of course, with prayer. Everything we should
everything we do should be saturated and steeped in prayer, both us praying for our congregations, praying with our congregations, inviting our congregations into prayer for us. So starting there, then of course moving into teaching our congregation, being formed by the word, that's a great way for us to be on that front line of discipleship. And then equipping our congregations through our prayers, through our teaching, so that they can be out making disciples in the community, and most importantly, releasing them to do that work over and over and over again, telling them that they are the ones that go out into the world and make disciples who then make disciples. I think that one of the key pieces of that is having a very clear discipleship process at your church, a way that people know that they can plug in to discipleship. And at Chapel Hill, it's not the same at every church, but at Chapel Hill, we've defined that as worship. We gather together to worship every single Sunday. So that's one way that we grow as disciples. Serve. We serve our local community. We serve our church. Connect. We connect in community through life groups. And then reaching others with the gospel. So worship, serve, connect, and reach others. And we try to plug people into that every way that we can. We try to work together to do that so it doesn't feel like one thing is getting more attention than the other, but that we're doing all of it at the same time so that we're raising up whole people, holistic disciples.
Michael.
Yes. Yes, ask your question again. And it's kind of hard to hear up here.
Yeah, it is a little hard to hear sometimes. The question is, what are your thoughts about how pastors can equip their church members to be discipling other people?
Yes, I want to keep beating the drum of what it means to be healthy. So a level of self-awareness means you need to have a congregational awareness. So it's your team, whatever, the people that are leading with you. I think that if when you know and acknowledge how those that are around you, where they are health-wise, it can actually help, because those that are leading will know and understand what emotional intelligence is necessary to engage certain leaders, because everybody's in a different space. There's nobody, you cannot disciple every single person the absolute same way, right? It requires you to have a level of awareness that means that those that have certain needs, there are people in your congregation that can actually assess those certain needs and meet those certain needs, whether that means therapy, whether that means something that that requires them to have a one-on-one relationship. But every discipleship relationship doesn't need to be one-on-one, nor does every discipleship relationship needs to be in a community group format. They vary, and therefore identifying what those look like and how they can be utilized will be helpful.
Gabriel, what's your perspective on this?
Well, as far as pastors equipping their people,
this is global workers as well. You're hitting it from every angle.
Well, I was going to make the connection. There are a lot of ways to answer this question. Some of the top things that come to my mind, I think of my own experience of being put on mission the first time. Mm-hmm. When I was a college student, I was not really sure why I was on that college campus, other than I was supposed to get a degree. And then the man who would be my mentor during the course of my college years said, "I think you are here to help bring people to Christ and to win this campus for Christ as well as get a degree." And I thought, "I am? Is that really why I'm here?" And then I started to hear, as I was involved with that campus ministry, that it was beyond that. It was that my purpose in life was to help fulfill the Great Commission. And then I was exposed to the world and invited to think about how I might invest my life in bringing the gospel to those who have never heard it. And I learned all that, thankfully, my freshman year in college. And that put me on mission in a way that I'd never known I was supposed to be. And that included my disciples saying, "Okay, you live in this area of the campus. How do you think God wants to use you to reach the people in your dorm?" And I thought, this is the most radical thing I've ever heard of. And that's, thankfully, that's the way I started thinking and believing and trusting in God, because that was really big. That threw me into a place of needing to trust God in a very specific way, feeling the dependence on him to do just that. I loved hearing from Mark and Keon just a little bit ago of how they are neighboring to listen, to engage, and then bear with and understanding. You know, like that whole process is exactly what our global workers need to do. You know, when we put them, when they're on assignment, I mean, it's kind of funny because the first couple of years, their responsibility is to learn the language and the culture and really not jump into, as Mark said it earlier, we're here to bring Jesus. We're trying to follow him and go where he is. And that takes time to decipher what is happening before you can actually figure out the best way to walk. But as far as discipleship, I think laying out the idea that we are actually on mission and all the way down to your specific plan. I mean, our global workers have a plan. I mean, it doesn't go, I mean, you know how plans go. But you set forth a plan and you put that before the Lord and you trust that these are the steps we're going to take. And, I'm on session, and I run into all kinds of people I love in my congregation who, that's never been a consideration. They don't think about their workplace as having a plan to do that. Once you put that kind of expectation on someone, and that this is the way we're going to live, this is the way we're going to act, they're going to start asking for some help to do that.
Thank you, Gabe. Kent, how can pastors equip their church members to be discipling people?
Do you have a slide for me? No? Okay, so briefly, I'm part of a 25-member foundation-funded think tank that has spent about 18 months researching. It's got another 18 months to go before we write our report. We're considering all the available research that we can find, and we're doing our own research around two topics. One of them is preparation of Christian leaders for ministry, and number two is disciple-making in the local church. I wish I had time to share with you all the things that we found so far, but one of the firmest convictions we have, which addresses this question, is if Jesus is our role model, how did Jesus do it? And here's the big problem. Most pastors aren't doing it the way Jesus did it. Is that the pastor then would identify key people, however many that is, 3 to 12, and would pour their life into those key leaders. Very few churches have pastors that are actually personally discipling their leaders or key disciples in their church. Jesus would then train them personally in a small group. He would take them out to do ministry with him. Eventually, he would turn over an increasing amount of responsibility of ministry to them, and all this in the context of preaching and teaching and conducting large group ministries, which would be the pool from which then other key and appropriate people are picked. Now, here's the key thing I want you to hear. We don't do disciple making the way Jesus did. If we're pastors, we tend to, the larger the church, think we're CEOs of a ministry organization, we got other people doing it. And the most successful pastors of their churches don't just show up in the big show, but they model from the pulpit and in their personal life what they want everybody else to do. You've heard the line that if you want it to be valued at the bottom, it has to be modeled at the top. In churches, we're discovering if you want it to be embraced at the bottom, it can't just be preached from the pulpit, it has to be modeled by the pastor. So, question I would ask every pastor is, how many people are you personally discipling? How many people are you taking with you to learn what you do in ministry so that you can train people to do ministry? And what is your system that isn't turning over the program to somebody else? Thank you.
Thank you, Kent. Oh, we have a request to get the slide back up. You can keep it up there while I go to the next question. Kent, because you were so patient and waiting to answer last, you get to answer this question first this time. So this is for you, Kent. What is a resource you can recommend for discipling people?
Do you have another slide for me?
He came prepared.
Well, you can't talk about, I don't think you can talk about resources without seeing what the resources are. No? Okay, Richard Borgonin is a upper-level manager at Lloyd's of London, the world's largest insurer. John Lennox, some of you know, is one of the top five apologists in terms of writing and influence in the world today. The two of them constructed a resource called the Word One-to-One. Word to One is both an evangelism tool to take a look at John 1 through 18, and it's also a fantastic instrument for doing initial discipleship or disciple making with somebody. Next slide. So it's this very interesting, very simple book that you have one and somebody else has one, and you just read through John. It gives you some questions to ask. It's also available on a phone app. I require every evangelism student I have to use it. I require every disciple-making student I have to find somebody and use it. It is the number one resource of the Canadian Bible Society, the Australian Bible Society, and the British Bible Society. They produce more of these and distribute more of these than any other resource they have. And the American Bible Society, rather than taking this, is trying to copy it and do their own thing. I don't know how to say more strongly to you that if you buy into the idea that the most effective disciple making is done one-on-one or personally, rather than thinking you'll be able to do it effectively in a large group or have a small group of people pick just some Christian book and read it together, that that constitutes disciple making. If you understand that, this is the single best tool I know for drawing somebody out into conversation, for allowing them to process without you lecturing them what the key concepts of the gospel and the Christian life are, and it directs them to the Bible in John chapter 1, verse 18. I wish we had time for me to share the other five that I think are fantastic, but I don't have time.
Thank you, Kent. Gabriel, what's a resource that you would recommend for discipleship?
Well, if you go to the EPCWO website, there are some opportunities that, again, we're here to serve you, and there's some opportunities that we have provided on there for people to step into. And so this is, you know, there a few of those things are, we have this thing called the college-age cohort, you know, so if you have college-age people in your congregation or recent graduates who have an inkling of an interest in missions. This is a group that meets online. It's a pretty low-level commitment, but it's been transformative for these young people. You actually saw, if you were here last night at the commissioning service, a number of young folks up here, recent college graduates, who are all part of that cohort at some point in time in the last few years. And all of them communicate how transformative that has been in their lives to understand the scope of the Great Commission and how they might fit in it. There's another course called the Kairos course. We have a partner out here in the exhibition lobby called Simply Mobilizing. But a couple of our WO folks, Nancy Simprich and Randy Hallbettle, lead that course. It's a 9-week course online. Many of you have taken it. And I continue to hear testimony after testimony of people who are being drawn to the heart of God in ways that they have never experienced before. People who are been very senior in their walk with the Lord, really finding new levels of understanding of their role in the kingdom. And so those are a couple of offerings that we provide just from a world outreach standpoint that you can step into pretty easily. Mark Vanderput, who is up here sharing about evangelism quite a bit, he leads another online course, Connecting with Your Muslim Neighbor. Actually, it's online or in person. Those are some opportunities. And then just on the topic of neighboring, there's you might know Chris and Elizabeth McKinney there at the Crossing Church in Missouri. They're on staff with Crew. He's a, EPC teaching elder. And they wrote a book called Placed for a Purpose. It's a really short book, very practical. You can use in small groups. And it's talking about how to neighbor well and in a kind of long form evangelism, being present as a couple, as a family, as a single person. And it's a great resource. I think you can cover that content in like 6 weeks, but it's very practical. You do it in a group, you actually do the assignments, you come back together. So it's not this kind of theoretical thing. So I just want to endorse that one too.
Excellent, thank you, Gabe. Julie, how about resources you would recommend for discipleship?
Yeah, so we live in like the age of infinite content, right? And that's true of Netflix. It's also true of discipleship resource, and it can become overwhelming. There is so much stuff out there, and there's always, I feel like every day in my inbox, I get a new, like, try this. This is the blueprint for how to make disciples. It can become so overwhelming. I think that, Kent, you're going to write this down. I think Kent's right, that the reading scripture together is the primary way that we can have a discipleship relationship with the people in our congregation. I also think that one of the greatest resources we have is our Presbyterian connectional system and the other local churches that are around us. And so I think that one of the best resources I would want to offer to you is the people sitting next to you from other churches and just asking them, what have you done at your church that has worked well? Because they've tried it, right? Like, you don't have to try it before you hear from somebody else how it worked for them. I know that for us, we have really loved Alpha. The Alpha course has been a great way for our people to be encouraged in their heart for evangelism and their heart for prayer for the lost. So that's something that we've used. If you want to talk more about that, I'm happy to talk to you about that. But I know that that might not be the right resource or tool for your situation. So I think that the greatest resource that we have is turning to the person next to us and saying, what have you tried? What has worked well for you? And then sharing that in your presbytery. We always have great trainings on discipleship in our presbytery. I really love how we lean into hearing from other churches. So I think that's really, it's such a stellar resource that we have as Presbyterians.
Well said. Michael.
Yeah, I'm going to keep hitting the self-awareness. So Roy Yankee as y'all heard, who is the executive director for Pastor in Residence. I think that I would recommend his tool, because when you don't know yourself, it can be any age. When we have a low self-awareness, what happens is our effectiveness in discipling others will be pretty low as well, because we would know what we can and cannot do. And so I think that helps there. His model comes with a coaching tool to kind of work through the assessment that he provides, and they will walk with you through that process. And I think as you continue to walk through that process, you'll understand how you can be better. All of us can be better in terms of discipling others according to how much more aware we are about ourselves.
Thank you all so much. Now, brothers and sisters, this is your opportunity. If you have a burning question regarding discipleship, please come forward. We have a microphone front and center here. We'd love to hear what's on your minds. It is a long walk from the back.
I'll be the first brave one. I've always been praying for the EPC that we would, a lot of our churches, some of our churches might be able to develop some seminary education things. And I saw Memphis City Theological Seminary, which sounds amazing. And briefly looking through your website, it sounds like you've taken kind of Briarwood, Birmingham Theological Seminary's model. Is that right? The Memphis City Seminary? Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
I'll have Michael speak to that because he's involved there. He's asking about the model at Memphis City Seminary since it was featured on our slide.
Yes, the model of, you're asking what are we doing there?
Yeah, I mean, it sounds amazing, especially for EPC church, raising up future leaders and so forth. And
totally understand. Sorry, it's kind of here. If you're sitting up here and they're talking, it's hard to hear.
Yeah.
But then when you're standing out there, it's hard to hear. So thank you. Memphis City Seminary is basically started to be comprehensive, affordable, and accessible. And it is to be a tool to develop leaders in Memphis, particularly. So Second Presbyterian is the church that has started it and has been a vehicle for many that are serving in ministry that it's not necessary that they haven't gone a traditional route. We want to be a resource for them in the city of Memphis so they can be developed. And this doesn't mean that they will always be an EPC leader, but they would also have some of the DNA from Second Presbyterian Church, which is an EPC church. George Robinson, who is, you would say, one of the founders, and so some of the other elders are here if you have other questions about that. I would also say Heartland Seminary, which Kent Mathews has 5 doctoral degrees, if you did not know. And Heartland Seminary is another seminary that has EPC, and it's fully online that you can also do work there.
Great. How can we pray for, as a denomination, how can we pray for the seminary and the other seminary as well?
Yeah, I would say pray. One of the things that we're feeling overall around the nation is that seminaries are in a deep decline, and so pray that we, to the Lord of the harvest, that he continues to allow us to develop more and send more, develop more pipelines so that there are people that want to have seminary education, and it doesn't necessarily have to be in a traditional format. So we pray for that.
Hi there. So listening, heard a couple of different elements. We've been talking about disciple making, talking about health. As a global worker with WO, we often talk about, healthy organisms or ones that reproduce. So if the goal is disciple making or making disciples, I'd love for each of you to just maybe try and help us with kind of a good working definition of a disciple. What's the end when we make disciples? What does that mean? If you guys could help define that.
So some of you may be familiar with the now almost dated book, Inside the Unchurched Harry and Mary by Willow Creek, in which they took a look at the demographic of their community and what they were trying to discern was the average person they were reaching and how they would, without compromising the gospel, reach them. I think that every church needs to come up with a definition of what is a disciple. You can come up with a biblical definition, but you in your session should sit down and draw a picture of what would a disciple look like if they begin at point A in our church and get to point Z in our church. What are they going to look like? Somebody who prays, somebody who studies the word, somebody who's involved in ministry, somebody who gives. I mean, you should come up with your own image of what it is, and I would suggest you present it to your session and your congregation, and you regularly say, this is our goal, that you would look like this, even if you use a stick figure, and so that everybody's on the same page in terms of what's the whole goal here. It isn't just for you to come and enjoy the sermons and the music and go home. It's for you to become like this person here. It's too abstract to say be like Jesus. It's better to say these are specific goals and characteristics that we're looking for.
Well, I would say that, that's a great idea, first of all. Yeah, and just to piggyback off what you're saying, I would hope that from a church standpoint, and I've actually not shared this idea with my own session, so if you're out there, we can talk more about that. But the, I would love to see, when we talk about what does an EPC disciple look like, and what does that mean from kindergarten to young adult, and what would you want that young adult to be like? What kind of skills would they have? What would they know? How would they practice life? What could they be capable of doing? What type of person would they be? And they would be a lot of the things that we've been talking about, what you've already talked about. You talked about resiliency. And so I would hope that, from being the world outreach director, that you know, by the time that someone is at a young adult, that they would be able, and I'll borrow a visual from my friend Thomas Davis, that they would be the type of person who is in tune with the Lord, who is on mission, and is capable to put up their sail wherever God has planted them, to catch the wind of the Holy Spirit, to be able to lead in launching, you know, spiritual movements in their own, wherever God has placed them. And so they'd be effective in evangelism and discipleship. They would be have the foresight to think about multiplication and having a missional impact, and considering what it means to help fulfill a great commission and where God has placed them. And so what would it take for a person to embody that? And at every stage of life, you know, all the way to that point. So, because we're talking about, I'm sorry, Bonnie moved. I went to look at Bonnie. She's not over there.
I'm here.
But, or Annie. Bonnie's over there. Okay. So, someone was talking about pipeline. And, you were talking about pipeline. I'm in so many conversations.
It's all good, Gabe.
And so I think that the discipleship plan should feed that pipeline for vocational ministers, for, you know, lay people, you know, that everyone is prepared and ready, skilled, resilient, to be able to do what God, to carry out that mission and be able to lead, so.
And I would just add to that, like, I think that I agree with what both Kent and Gabriel said. I think that it's important for your church to have that process defined, to say this is what it means to be a disciple in our context. And of course, there are some things that should be true of every church, that a disciple of Jesus looks like this anywhere you go. But the things that I would add to your process is it's something that should be ongoing. I think that there's a danger in making it like a checklist, like, oh, I served, now I get to level up, and now I'm going to go into boss mode and or whatever, right? Like, it's not something that you can that you complete. As long as we are on this earth, we are in a part of that ongoing discipleship process. So recognizing that it's not a checklist, it's something that we'll always be working towards. I think also emphasizing that it's something that we do in community with one another is really important too, because I think it's very easy for us to make discipleship an individual thing, but it's best done in community. So emphasizing those two points to your congregation, and also recognizing that there are seasons when one part of your process might be what a person needs in that moment. Like Gabriel talked a little bit about having a bit of an individualized approach to discipleship. Now, for some people, in the season that they're in, service might be a way that is really going to grow them and grow them to be more like Jesus. And so you want to encourage them to go into service, where later it might be leading a life group or something like that. It might be an and situation where serving and leading a life group is what they need at this moment. So just recognizing that there are seasons when you want to really lean into things for your community and for an individual person. So that's what I would add to it. You got our next question.
Hi, this is kind of touching on what you said, Julie, about not stopping discipleship until you see glory. How can we practically merge our generations within our church to disciple one another? But particularly, how can we encourage our older members to disciple the younger members and get a spirit of, you know, rejuvenation or something to pour into our younger members and to make that discipleship culture be led by them? Do you have any examples, any of you, of practical stories or tools that we could use to encourage our older people to disciple our younger people, and our younger people to not be intimidated to ask our older congregants to share with them the life? I think a lot of our older congregants are intimidated because, you know, they don't know how, or they're not a pastor, they didn't go to seminary. But we know that that's not all you need to disciple someone. And so could you share with us just that obstacle that we face with a multi-generational church?
So I think that making intergenerational relationship programmatic is difficult because the second that you make it a program, it makes it feel less relational. It makes it feel like a program. And so I know that I am a product of mentoring. I know that everyone up here is a product of mentoring. I know that Kent has been a mentor to me and many of us in this room. And so I think that one of the best ways to do it is to tell those stories of mentoring relationships and provide environments for those relationships to happen, like have areas of the church where people are hanging out and having conversations, but also tell those stories from up front, tell stories of people pouring into one another. And I think that what you said about the older generation not necessarily wanting, feeling like they have the expertise or ability to speak into it, that is like the beautiful part of that ongoing discipleship, is because they're saying, I don't have all the answers. And it takes an extraordinary amount of humility to say that. And so if we have our older generation saying, I don't have all the answers, but I still want to walk with you and we can learn from one another. And I love this about Rosemary. I have the gift of having Rosemary Lukens at my church. But one of the things I love about Rosemary is she always talks about how she learns from us younger people. And man, we're learning so much from her. But she always talks about how she learns from us too. And so it shows that mutual relationship. So I think the more that we show that and talk about it and exhibit it, the more it will happen naturally and it won't feel like it's forced. But it feels like it's just an outpouring of who we are.
Something that we started doing at our church was having an intergenerational brunch. And so just creating that space around the table for, you know, young and old to be around the table and just kind of have prompted questions and then an open time. And it's always been packed and the conversations have been robust and it's been really fun to hear, you know, the last time we did this, there was a teenager at my table who I didn't know, and then there were a couple of people who've been a part of our church for like three generations, and just to hear kind of those stories really connects us in a really powerful way to know that, oh wow, this church has been here a long time, God has been faithful to this community, and it kind of paints this picture and creates a stronger community and can open up those discipleship relationships too, just having that time and space. So not strongly programmatic, but just creating that time and place and space has been really a great blessing to us. So
I just want to add to what Julie and Gabe said. We too hosted dinners where actually we had the youth group make all the food and hosted it for the senior saints. But a mixed bag is also a good idea. And then something that you can do at your churches to do organic discipleship is have small groups not be insular. So if small groups can be married and singles and senior saints and youth, then you're organically learning from one another.
Rick Dietzman, come on up to the mic. He's been very patient.
It's okay. I don't get it. Oh, there we go. Yeah, so my name is Rick Dietzman. I am an associate pastor in our presbytery. And I had an interesting experience a few years ago because we're a mid-sized church. And I realized I was doing it alone. I was doing a lot of small group ministry, discipleship ministry. But I wasn't really interacting with the other churches in the presbytery. And in 2019... a group of our associate pastors decided to start to get to know each other and share. And this is a little bit what Julie was speaking to earlier. And then as I kept just talking to people in the presbytery, especially smaller churches, I realized there was a large group of leaders that were not the senior pastors, that were either elders, some of them are youth workers, some of them are working with adult ministry, adult education, some are trying to do outreach discipleship, but they weren't coming to presbytery. They weren't linking so much, and you had to go find them. Sort of like missions people, the same thing happens. I'm involved in that as well. You've got to go find the missions chairperson of the church. And I realized this is a whole group of people that maybe are invisible, but are really trying to do discipleship. So as I'm hearing about the resourcing for Next Gen, I'm hearing about resourcing for executive pastors, for example, I would maybe make a suggestion or maybe a thought about this, since it's such an important topic. Is there a possibility of developing a resourcing network for those who are the practitioners in the Church of Discipleship, who are working perhaps with a senior pastor, associate pastor, or a director, an elder, a ministry leader, that we could create some kind of retreat and that kind of thing and really workshop this together so that we can equip a lot of churches? That would be my question, or anybody given any thought to that?
Well, I'm not going to answer that. I'll answer that. You want to answer it?
I think, Rick, like, yes, we are thinking about that and talking about that and always trying to create those environments. And I mean, you do a great job of doing that in our presbytery, so thank you for the way that you bring people together. But, like, it's actually kind of the heart of the EBL team is bringing people together from all these different areas and starting those conversations. So, yeah.
So I have three quick thoughts for your question. Number one is that most people of the next to the oldest and the oldest generation are desperate for legacy. This is actually more of a problem or an issue for men than it is for women. But guys are looking for legacies. I can't think of a better legacy to sell older adults in our churches than you can have an impact by doing this. But they must be discipled first. It would be unreasonable to say, let's start this intergenerational discipleship ministry where you start discipling people without very intentionally discipling those individuals so that they then felt both authorized and competent to do it. I forgot which speaker said this afternoon. I don't know that I totally agree with this. The big issue in evangelism is no longer fear. I still think it is, but it's I don't know enough. Most people don't know enough about discipleship to disciple somebody else. So it would be a wonderful idea in a church if you would disciple the disciplers and then set the disciplers free to multi-generationally disciple people. Part of the problem with that, though, is that most 20-year-olds probably aren't going to get excited about being discipled by a 70-year-old. I don't know. I could be wrong. But some of that would work. Some of it wouldn't work. You just have to be sensitive to different people want to connect with other different people. But it's a great question, and that's going to make me start thinking about that myself.
We have one more question from the floor.
I'm sorry, I'm here to kind of add to that conversation as well. The question of how do we do intergenerational discipleship, because that's really important, because our older saints need a sense of meaning and purpose in their lives, and our younger saints need older people to demonstrate a lifelong faith for them. So thankfully I got to experience that myself growing up in youth group. So this is a practical recommendation, but the small groups in your youth ministries, you know, ask your older saints to be the leaders for those. And they're there, and it is a little programmed, but it can be relational. And that's been done really well for me before. So I recommend that. And just, so for example, we have an older guy at our church who loves to tell stories. And he has literally sailed all over the world, so he has some good ones. And we're just sitting after church, having a meal. We had an eighth grade boy, and Steve is just telling stories, and we're dead silent, just listening, including our eighth grader, which is a miracle, by the way. And afterward, I had to talk to both of them separately. I said, Wyatt, you know, Steve was telling a story, and you listened to him, and he got to give something to you. And I want you to think about, you know, what is Steve trying to teach you through his story? And then when I told Steve, hey, Steve, your stories are valuable and they communicate something about your life of faith, just tears started rolling down his eyes. So just stuff like that.
Yeah. Hey, I want to wrap up our time. George, you don't have to leave. Yeah, I'm just joking with you, George. It's just discipleship. I want to wrap up, but first of all, I want to thank you all for sitting patiently and those that have come up to the microphone. I think that one word that comes to my mind when we hear so many different perspectives is contextualization. Contextualization. From when I became a Christian in a predominantly African-American setting, and therefore discipleship looked incredibly different. When I went to the mission field and was able to go to Buenos Aires several times and lead young adult trips when I was at Second Press, discipleship looked completely different. And then being at a church plant, like Downtown Church, discipleship look completely different. And now being at the Office of General Assembly, discipleship looks a wide array of different ways. And so that is what Julie mentioned, that we actually have ways, stories, and tools to resource one another. And we want to inspire and connect you all to do that. Therefore, we don't necessarily have to find and seek a silver bullet to discipleship, because it's virtually impossible depending upon where you come from and where you are, how many resources you have and how much you do not have. But I want to emphasize something that we started off this time with. Discipleship cannot be effective. We cannot be effective biblical leaders if we are not healthy. We cannot be effective biblical leaders if we're not healthy. A low self-awareness will cause you to feel, inflict hurt and pain and whatever's going on with you amongst God's people. You can see that in various different relationships. And so what do we walk away with this from? We all need to learn and continue to grow and take a posture of being a disciple, because as we do that, we will then begin to grow in leading other people, no matter what age you are in. Why do I say that? Because young people who, whatever we deem as young people, don't be afraid to be empowered to use your voice, because the Bible teaches us that young people have something to say as well. We can learn from infants all the way to those that are, you know, 100 years old. And that is just true because of how God created all of us. Amen, somebody? So thank you. And let me pray for our time. Before I do, will you please give God praise for these individuals? Take your time. All right, let's say a quick word of prayer. Father, we come to you knowing that you're the one that knows all of us. And I pray, God, that as you do, some of the things that have been said here, I pray that we catch it. Things that have been taught, I pray, God, that we walk with it. But things that we still have questions about, I pray that we inquire, we ask. And the experience that we had, that we share, help us, God, to continue to be connectional and very much family-oriented in the way that we continue to do the work in which you've placed before us. Allow us, Lord Jesus, to understand that we are being called to this work, and that those things that cause us to be hurt, those things that cause us to be exhausted, that we can reach out to somebody to help us to continue to grow and flourish for your glory. For we pray this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. All God's people say together,
amen.
Amen.